Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 12th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Before we begin, a reminder that social distancing measures are in place across Holyrood, so please follow those guidelines when entering and leaving the committee room. We have apologies from Natalie Dawn, and Colette Stevenson attends as a substitute this morning. At item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 7 and 8 in private. Item 7 is consideration of the evidence heard in relation to the draft fuel poverty strategy, and item 8 is consideration of evidence heard on the proposed single-use plastics legislation. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. Our first substantive item today is an evidence session on the draft fuel poverty strategy. I welcome Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport, and Naeem Bhatti, Head of the Fuel Poverty and Housing Standards Unit. Good morning, both. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. This provides the Parliament, through this committee, the opportunity to scrutinise and comment on the draft fuel poverty strategy before it is finalised. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you would want to make a brief opening statement, so I will hand over to you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. The Fuel Poverty Strategy builds on the draft strategy published back in 2018 and identifies a comprehensive range of actions to address all four drivers of fuel poverty. Our statutory fuel poverty targets to 2040 are both ambitious and challenging. These targets will be even more challenging to achieve as the pace of change demanded by our climate change targets is unprecedented, and the costs needed to support fuel-poor households to transition to net zero are significant, as we are committed to ensuring no one is left behind. However, despite this, there are potential tensions between the drive to decarbonise heat and the reduction of fuel poverty. Work to decarbonise homes and buildings over the next two decades will be led and coordinated by the new National Public Energy Agency, which we have committed to establish by 2025. A virtual agency will be in place by September next year and will work in line with a set of guiding principles as set out in our Heat in Buildings strategy to support fuel poverty and net zero ambitions. To help inform and design and develop the new agency, I'm pleased to announce that today we've launched an early call for evidence that I would invite anyone interested in this agenda to respond to in the coming weeks. The recent sharp rise in energy prices, as well as other pressures on household finances, have highlighted the challenges that sudden changes in income and energy prices pose. The Scottish Government has taken steps to support people through the winter months through additional funding made available to third sector organisations. I'm already taking action within devolved competence, but over the longer term, we need to see action from the UK Government, especially in terms of how energy markets and energy prices can support both our fuel poverty and net zero ambitions. We'll work with the Scottish Fuel Poverty Advisory Panel once appointed and a wide range of stakeholders to shape and develop the strategy as we progress implementation. A formal consultation with the panel will take place later next year. And I hope this is helpful, Convener, and obviously I'm happy to respond to any questions that the committee may have.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, very helpful indeed. You mentioned the recent price increases in the energy market, which have generated a lot of headlines. I wonder if you could just talk us through your perspective in terms of how those price increases have impacted fuel poverty levels in Scotland.
So at this stage, it's difficult to assess exactly the impact that they will have. The next set of data we'll have on fuel poverty figures is likely to be December next year, which will pick up on the increase in prices which we've seen, particular spike we've seen in recent months. It's one of the key drivers, though, one of the four key drivers that creates fuel poverty. So there's every likelihood that it will increase the number of people who are experiencing fuel poverty and also increase the depth of extreme fuel poverty that some individuals will experience. We are continuing to see rises in fuel prices overall, which, going from a discussion I had with the Chair and Chief Executive of Ofgem just last week, there is no indication or any sign that increase will start to abate in the near future. So there are individuals who are now, and households are now, increasingly find themselves in difficulty because of the escalating costs associated with the spike in fuel prices, which is likely to continue through the winter months. So my expectation is that it will increase fuel poverty, which is why we've taken action to provide support during the winter months, as we did last year, to support those households who are experiencing particular difficulties, with the additional £10 million that we're providing over the winter, which is alongside the £25 million that we were already providing to try to help to meet some of the needs for those who are experiencing fuel poverty. So my expectation is that it will increase fuel poverty and also increase the depth of extreme fuel poverty for some households.
Okay, thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. I'll hand over to my colleagues after this second question I have. Scotland has some of the oldest housing stock in Europe, as you know. What are the particular policies in place that the Scottish Government is pursuing to address the particular challenges faced by households in older housing stocks such as tenements?
Now, you raise a good point, because we do have a housing stock in some parts of the country which is much more challenging for us to make fuel efficient, given its age and design nature, and that's particularly acute in some of our rural communities. You can see from the fuel poverty data that their local authorities that have predominantly rural areas have a greater degree of fuel poverty and extreme fuel poverty, largely as a result of the types of properties which they have. But we also have it in cities such as Edinburgh as well, particularly in tenement-type properties and older properties. So the Heating Buildings strategy, which we published just a few weeks ago, sets out the approach that we're taking in order to help to not only tackle the issue around carbon emissions from properties, but also to help to improve fuel efficiency and to help to insulate properties much more effectively to reduce their energy needs. So I think the key approach that we have is through our programmes, through the social housing programmes which we provide to local authorities to help to support them in their energy efficiency programmes and replacement of heating systems, which over, I think, since 2008 we've almost invested £1 billion in, alongside the ongoing work that we'll take forward to help to decarbonise properties in the years ahead. And we've already committed £1.8 billion to that programme over the course of this parliamentary term. So that combination of looking to decarbonise properties while also making them much more fuel efficient is a principal way that we're going about trying to help to support people in moving out of fuel poverty.
Okay, thank you. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop, please.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
Can you maybe share with us what you think are the biggest risks in delivering this fuel poverty strategy?
Oh, I think there are a whole range of different risks associated with tackling fuel poverty. I mentioned, as we set out in the strategy, there are four key areas around tackling fuel poverty. Fuel prices, energy efficiency, the way in which fuel is used, and also incomes and households, all of which are interrelated to one another. So if you take, for example, the work that we're taking forward just now to help to improve energy efficiency in the social housing stock, and also through some of the other programmes that for private homeowners users can get for improving their energy efficiency. Some of that work in terms of making progress is positive, because it can help to reduce people's fuel needs and their fuel use, which is benefits not only them financially but also from an environmental point of view. However, there will be households who are presently still experiencing fuel poverty or extreme fuel poverty just now, or maybe on the edge of getting into experiencing fuel poverty, that will find, because of the escalating price of their energy costs, is that they find themselves being tripped into fuel poverty or into even deeper fuel poverty. So I think the challenges here is that there are a range of different moving parts. So some of the areas where we have powers to improve fuel efficiency and trying to improve more efficient heating systems in homes can be quite readily undermined by a spike in energy prices or other actions that have an impact on household incomes. So inflation costs in general, where household costs are increasing, which means that people don't have the same disposable income to meet ongoing household needs. So there are factors out with the actual material aspect of the building that can have an impact. And that's why some of the actions that we've been taking forward will take us so far But we need to see collective action, I believe, around the energy markets and how we can create greater stability within energy markets in particular, so we don't see these big spikes in prices which have a negative impact on household incomes. And one of the things that we've asked the UK government to do, and through BEIS and ministers there, is to specifically look at the way in which the existing energy markets are operating, how the levy schemes operate around different types of fuel types. So there's heavier levies on things like electricity than there is on gas, how the existing levy scheme operates and how that could be used in a way that also helps to press down the increasing number of people who may be experiencing fuel poverty. So I think there's an interaction between devolved and reserved issues, but there are external factors that can have an impact on fuel poverty figures over a very short period of time, as I expect the spike in energy prices will cause in the months ahead.
And clearly there's a challenge in Scotland about rural, but also semi-rural communities. Even in my constituency, in the dead centre of Scotland, between the M8 and the M9, we've got people living with oil-based fuel. So that combination of trying to get to net zero at the same time as all these other risk factors are at play really can have an impact on a large number of people in Scotland. So how will this fuel poverty strategy and the changes that you're making within this paper that you've presented, how will it particularly help them? And it's not just about advice, it's actually about practical help, which there's a bit of a gap just now. Will this strategy address it? Because it's not clear where the money is and where the delivery mechanism and grants will actually be.
Yeah, so there's a combination of things. So there's the work we're doing around heat and buildings strategy, not just in social housing, but also in private housing, will be a key part of helping to support and deliver on our objectives that are set out within the fuel poverty strategy itself and our statutory targets within that. If I maybe just pick up on a couple of examples that you mentioned there. So, for example, rural areas. So we know that fuel poverty is higher in rural areas, both at a fuel poverty level and also an extreme fuel poverty level. So we have the area-based programmes that we provide to local authorities to support them with energy efficiency measures that they can take forward within their respective local authority areas. That's got a weighting towards it that helps to provide further resource and support to rural communities to try and help to support them, given that they've got a bigger, a more extensive problem or greater number of people who are experiencing fuel poverty. So some of the programmes that we have been amended to take greater recognition of rurality. In the most recent funding arrangements with COSLA as well, we have introduced a new funding arrangement with COSLA, which again helps to address the weighting issue around local authorities have got greater levels of fuel poverty in order to make sure that more of the money is directed towards these particular areas as well. I think the second issue is in relation to, you mentioned, for example, some of your own constituents in central Scotland, in West Lothian, who are using oil-based heating systems, is that in helping to address the transition towards using non-fossil fuel-based heating systems is how we can help to drive down the costs or also to increase the amount of funding that may be available to individuals who are looking to replace their heating system to one which is a low-carbon-based system. So some of the changes we've made as well in the programme is, for example, is that some of the funding's gone from what was about a maximum of £9,000 up to £14,000 to help to support some of the transitions, particularly in rural areas, that might be necessary to using a low-carbon system. So we're trying to calibrate the funding formula of how money goes to local authorities to reflect where the greatest pockets of fuel poverty are, and also in our heating buildings programme to try and look at how we can make sure that the loans and grant-based systems are calibrated in a way that they provide a greater level of funding to those who may be in areas where they are off-grid and they have to look at alternative systems that may be more costly than those who would be on that could use an on-grid system. And it's trying to make sure that that funding flows in a way that recognises that greater level of need.
Thank you. I'm quite happy to pass on to colleagues.
Thanks very much. Fiona, Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks. I think just taking that a little bit deeper in terms of rural communities, I mean, obviously, at the moment, there's a big cost differential between installing a low-carbon system and maybe sticking with an oil-based system, and is to get your views really on how that cost reduction can come down over time. And I think perhaps one of the issues that people raise with me is just around the wider kind of servicing infrastructure as well. If people are being asked to kind of make a jump to a low-carbon system, and there maybe isn't the supply chain there, there isn't the reduction in costs there, but there maybe isn't the kind of maintenance and supply, you know, servicing kind of infrastructure, that will be a concern, a barrier to people making a jump over. So, yeah, I'm interested in what thinking is coming through the heat and building strategy and how that merges with the targets here.
So that's a key part of the heat and building strategy, is to look at how we can try to mitigate some of these challenges. There is no doubt that as new technology comes onto the market, or people are early adopters of technology that's low carbon or zero carbon, is that very often the costs tend to be higher at the earlier stages of it. But the general sense in the market is that as demand grows, is that costs will start to decline as the sector starts to develop capacity, and also it becomes much more common for people to be using and deploying low-emission heating systems. I think one of the challenges that we have going forward, though, is that trying to get the scale of change that we're looking for in the years ahead will potentially it poses a risk of pushing people into fuel poverty, because systems could be more expensive for them to both adopt and potentially use. That's why the Public Energy Agency will have an important role in helping to try and coordinate and plan that work. So one of the things that we're looking at doing is, for example, is how can we make sure that we are coordinating action across our local authorities, so we've not got local authorities or social housing providers all going off trying to do it 32 different ways, or trying to go away and do it 200 different ways for housing associations. Is we're trying to provide some coordination to that, and that actually can help to drive down costs through the use of the agency and helping to coordinate some of that action, and also looking to how we can plan some of the introduction of these types of measures in a way that helps to drive down some of the costs. If I was to say to you, though, are we seeing a shift in the sector in recognising that this is where things are going to go? I think in Freer and Hislop's own constituency, the investment that's just recently been made by Mitsubishi at the Livingston plant on air source heat pumps is a clear indication that they see this as being a growing market, not just for Scotland and the UK, but also across Europe. So I think we're starting to see it move in that direction, but we need to make sure we're taking coordinated action to try and help drive down costs, and that's one of the roles that the agency will have in trying to help to support that work.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously you've announced the consultation into the establishment of the agency today, and you're talking, I think, now about a setup of next year rather than
virtual setup.
So in terms of work on that supply chain then, I mean, how would you see the energy agency coordinating action there? What will it practically do? Is it going to rely more on local government delivery partners or voluntary sector agencies? I mean, I think just some clarity over what the agency will practically is envisaged to do on the ground to help tackle some of these issues and roll out programmes would be useful.
So I don't want to preempt the consultation, the feedback we get from the consultation, but for example, one of the areas that it could look to do is to help to coordinate the planning of works for the decarbonisation of social housing. So how do we, for example, bring together housing associations to help to look at coordinating some of their joint planning for the decarbonisation of their heating systems? So rather than them going away, if they've got a housing stock of 500, looking to just do it for 500, it may be actually working with several other housing authorities or social housing providers, they could drive down the cost by bringing the works together. That's the sort of thing that the agency could help to provide support and advice around, and how they can coordinate that, which gives them a bigger purchasing power, and also could help to mitigate against some of the risks of trying to do it on their own as well. So that's a practical example of one of the things that the agency could actually assist in doing. Second area is, as I think I've mentioned this committee before, is how we can develop the heat as a service and how that could potentially lead to what would be local hearing providers within local communities to help to support development in that area, to help to assist. It may be, again, social housing providers or local authorities that are looking at that as a model through the district hearing systems. It's trying to help to provide them with expertise and advice and help to coordinate some of that action so that, you know, if they're trying to do it in Stirling and Stirling Council looking at it and Falkirk Council looking at it is, well, actually, how can we join some of this together so we're getting some shared learning? Again, that could be a role for the agency, and it's one of the things that we're asking during the course of the consultation for feedback on specifically and how that could help to support that area of work developing.
Okay, great. Just one question. An issue was raised for me yesterday with Fife Council about default providers for council tenants of energy and how it's very difficult now to get energy companies to become the default provider for council tenants. SSE, I think, are not interested in being the default provider for Fife Council. I wonder if that was an issue that you were aware of, because obviously now we're seeing more and more energy companies going to the wall. The number of energy companies that are actually there able to provide a competitive offering for council tenants is going to be getting less and less. So there seems to be a lack of appetite to take on council tenants, which is worrying.
I'm not aware of the specific issue in Fife, and if you want to provide me with more information on it, I'm more than happy to look into it. The way in which it operates just now is that if an energy provider drops out of the market, the most recent being Bulb last week, which is going into a special administration arrangement, which is different from what's happened to the other providers. I think there's now something like 21 providers have dropped out the market, is that Ofgem actually allocate their customers to another service provider, so through the operator of last resort arrangements. So they reallocate their customers. That scheme continues to operate. So if someone's with if you're a Bulb customer, you are in a slightly different position because the government's effectively taking that on as a special administrator. But if you were with People's Energy, that was a Scottish-based company that withdrew from the market, then you were transferred to another energy provider on the basis of their rates as well. One thing I would say is that I think given the number of companies who have moved out of the market, the companies that are left to pick up these customers are finding that increasingly challenging, so because they are having to absorb significant numbers of customers. So there is a wider systemic issue within the sector that I believe needs to be addressed, and it's an issue which I've raised with, I raised it with the Kwasi Kwarteng in a discussion early on when this issue started to emerge, and I think it's an issue that BEIS still need to address, and I discussed that again with Ofgem last week. There are systemic problems within the energy market that need to be addressed, and that requires action at a UK level.
Okay. Thank you, Mark. Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Very briefly, Scotland has adopted a suite of definitions different from those being used in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Why was that out of interest?
In definitions in terms of what?
In terms of things like fuel poverty. It's very difficult to make a direct comparison between data because there are different definitions, and I just wonder why that might be.
Predates me because it was through the Parliament. I don't know if Naeem can say a bit more about that, but part of it, my understanding was to try and provide a much more accurate reflection of the situation in Scotland. So, for example, some of the baseline data which is used by the UK government doesn't reflect the specific challenges that we have in rural communities. And therefore, the definition which was adopted in the Fuel Poverty Act was one which was to give us a much more accurate picture of the depth and scale of fuel poverty in Scotland. So, for example, the Warm Homes Discount Scheme that operates at a UK level, so the threshold for that, for example, for some households in Scotland, is simply it's too high. And it means that some households in Scotland who are experiencing fuel poverty don't qualify for it. And it was one of the reasons why, again, there was consideration of, there was a look at changing the definition. But now you may be able to say a wee bit more about the history of it, given that Parliament's scrutiny of it during the course of the passage of the Act.
Yeah, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. As the Cabinet Secretary says, this definition was agreed by Parliament because to take account of the unique circumstances for the country as a whole. Some of the definitions in England, they are not aligning to the needs of us because of more rural areas, more geographical spread. Some of the challenges that we have around, you know, supply and trying to get the, you know, different tenements and buildings upgraded. So some of those, so the definition was based on what does Scotland need, and it doesn't align with the UK, with the England ones. It doesn't align with Wales one because they're taking a different approach. So our approach is looking at, you know, what is the fuel poverty after housing costs and other incomes have been taken into account. And as the Cabinet Secretary just highlighted, Warm Home Discount and ECO, you know, they are targeting a particular people of for support, but that doesn't meet our requirements around it. So that's the reason for it. And this was agreed by Parliament, the definition.
I understand. Thanks for the comprehensive reply. Cabinet Secretary, you said in your opening remarks that there's a tension between achieving a reduction in fuel poverty and achieving other policy objectives, such as the transition to net zero. How do you foresee that tension being resolved, and which will take priority where you can't resolve that tension?
I don't think we should see it as an either-or. I think we have to see both of them as going hand in hand. So I think the tension is, so for example, a practical tension is that a lot of the zero-emission energy systems that could be deployed within homes are electricity-based systems. So right now, the levies which are applied by the UK government on energy are greater for electricity than they are for gas. So as we see that transition away from using carbon-based heating systems to low-carbon or zero-carbon-based systems, we need to see that being reflected in the levy system because it potentially drives up the cost, given the way in which it's presently calibrated. Can't simply do that overnight. It's got to be done on a gradual basis, because the danger is if you just shift it all over to gas, as you put folk that are using gas still, into fuel poverty. I think the big challenge here around the transition, which is addressed in the heating and building strategy, is how you drive down the cost of the installation of zero emission or low carbon heating systems, while at the same time taking forward energy efficiency measures. They need to go hand in hand. And that's going to be the real challenge, and a big part of that is how we drive down the costs and then the ongoing usage cost. And given that many of, for example, air source heat pumps, etc., are dependent on electricity, we then at a UK level need to see the levy system starting to reflect that shift to zero emission heating systems and to ensure that it's not pushing more people into fuel poverty.
Thank you for that. On that exact point, and I'm going to go ever so slightly local, as my friend Mark Ruskell did earlier, just now, because it's come up. You talked a lot there about investing in heating systems to decarbonise properties, and certainly in the draft report, in the draft strategy, and just in your answer there, you talked about heat pumps powered by electricity. Now, given the catastrophe of the last few days, what are you going to do to convince people that electricity and electric-powered heating is the way to go, particularly in the more rural areas that my friends were looking at earlier? And what contingency planning would be done such that if everyone were to move to electric-powered heating, that if we have the catastrophe that we've had over the last few days, they're not left freezing in houses in rural areas?
Well, of course, you know, given the very serious difficulty that we've had over the course of the last few days and continues for households today that are off-grid, is that many of them live in areas where they're already off the gas grid. Mm-hmm. So their only option is gas or oil-based heating systems. As you would always expect during the course of or after any major event like this, we need to make sure that utility companies such as SSEN and Scottish Power Energy Networks are looking to see whether there are further measures they could put in place to try and help to minimise the loss of power in the way in which they've experienced. However, I think we have to reflect on the fact that the level of faults and difficulties which have been experienced across the network is unprecedented. You know, I've heard over the course of the last few days that compared to, I think it's three times the number of faults that they experienced during the Beast of the East. You know, at some one point, they had over 500 faults in their system trying to repair them. So, So I think looking to see what more you can do in terms of resilience. I think one of the other aspects here is how you can also help to develop potentially local heating systems as well and local energy systems. And as I mentioned to Mark Ruskell, one of the options around using things like district energy systems is that it provides you with greater local resilience because it is much more self-sufficient. So I think there's potential for that. It's more challenging in rural areas because of the way in which population dispersed, but it has the potential. But of course, key thing is that when faults are found is that they're addressed as quickly as possible when we try and get folk back on online and provide them with support during what is a difficult time.
Thanks very much, Liam. Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
I'm just going to ask, how far do you think can devolved policy measures address fuel poverty in Scotland, and how important is wider reform in the UK's energy market?
So I think there is... I think it'd be fair to say, I think there's a shared interest at both a UK and government, UK and Scottish government level to tackle fuel poverty. However, there are more extreme levels of it in Scotland because of the nature of our geography and housing type. So it's important that that the UK government are taking the actions that are necessary to support us in helping to achieve our fuel poverty targets and to make sure that the measures that they're taking can assist us in achieving that. And I mentioned, for example, the way in which the levy systems are operating and how that, you know, not just changing it randomly, but how you could plan for that to be changed in a transitional way that helps to reduce fuel poverty going forward. There is no doubt in my mind there needs to be a systemic shift in the energy market. So if you look at what's happened largely over the course of the last couple of months with the companies that have withdrawn, there are largely two types of energy providers. There are those which are called hedged and those that are unhedged. So those that are hedged have actually bought their gas and electricity ahead. So they've bought it, you know, some of them buy it, you know, maybe 18 months ahead, some 6 months ahead, some 3 months ahead. And those that are unhedged are basically buying it on the market each day. So what you've seen and what you've witnessed is largely those who were, not all of them, but the majority of those who were unhedged have actually dropped out of the market because it's just not sustainable. So there's a systemic issue in the way in which the industry is operating in that should we have been in a position where companies were unhedging on our energy source, our primary energy source, in a way that quite literally has left millions of customers having to be transferred to other providers. So there's a regulatory aspect in there that needs to be addressed. I think the second thing that it highlights is the need to decarbonise our heating system so that we move away from the need for carbon-based heating, particularly gas-based heating. And I know that that's a view which is shared by the UK government, is that they feel this highlights the need for us to look at decarbonising it quicker and in a way that reduces our dependency on fossil fuels. So I'd like to think there's a shared interest, and certainly from my discussions with them, there is a shared interest in it, but it's important we also see the policy actions being taken that give us greater certainty in the market, but also at the same time that help to address fuel poverty in a way that that is shared with their own strategy and the UK government's own plans for tackling fuel poverty.
Okay. Jackie, let me bring in Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. My questions have partly been covered because I was keen to ask about the National Public Energy Agency, because I was surprised in the quite chunky draft strategy there's no mention of the agency, but you have said, Cabinet Secretary, that a consultation has started today. I can't see that online yet, so perhaps just for the benefit of the committee, can you tell us how the agency fits with the strategy and when the agency might begin? Because we're a bit behind in terms of what we thought would be a public energy company that would have a role in generation, and that didn't happen. So how can we be confident that the new agency that's proposed will come along quite quickly?
Not sure. I think the agency was referred to within our heat and building strategy around the fuel poverty strategy, if I remember correctly. So, because it sits there more than within the fuel poverty strategy, although the agency will have a clear guiding principle about helping to support us in decarbonising domestic heating systems, but also helping to address fuel poverty as well. And that's two of its key principles that it will take in going forward. I mentioned earlier on some of the work that the agency can actually take forward in helping to coordinate and plan some of the work around decarbonising folks' properties, and also how that can also sit alongside tackling fuel poverty as well. And that's part of why we're taking forward the consultation. I think it would be fair to say that the feedback we've had from across the sector is supportive of the role that an agency can have in helping to coordinate this action. You'll be aware there's a range of different organisations that are already engaged in some of this work. Having a national agency that will be able to draw that together and help to plan some of that on a more strategic level, and also to provide expertise and guidance, I think will be extremely valuable. And as I mentioned, I think previously, and I think maybe to your question to yourself, when I was last at the committee around the shift in our approach from moving from a public energy, moving to a public energy agency, as we set out in our manifesto and it was in our programme for government this year, is a reflection of what is a big shift in what we now have to do in decarbonising 1 million homes and 50,000 non-domestic premises between now and 2030, which is a colossal undertaking, and we need to try and help to plan and manage that as effectively as possible, guided by the principles of decarbonisation and also tackling fuel poverty, and that will be a key role for the agency moving forward.
I'm grateful for the clarification. I suppose just in terms of joining things together, which I think was a phrase you used yourself earlier on, Cabinet Secretary, I just was surprised that there wasn't a reference to the National Public Energy Agency in this document, but that's helpful what you've said. I suppose I just wonder, I appreciate from the government's point of view you think the situation has changed, therefore a public energy company is no longer the right approach, but in terms of the spirit of the cooperation agreement, is that something that can be looked at again, and that, you know, the Parliament can have a role in revisiting? Because I think given the challenges that we face, you know, we do need to be ambitious and look at how we can really get big system change. So is that something that you think that government will keep an open mind to?
So I think I said when I was at the committee the last time is I'm very open to the model of looking at how we can develop heat as a service. So I think that's we've actually signed a memorandum of understanding with the Danish government specifically on this, to look at they've got more experience in this area than we have in the public sector, to look at how we can develop that model in a more in-depth way, and in a way that I believe can help to deliver what was some of the intended outcomes from a public energy company, but in a way that is much more consistent with delivering on our net zero ambitions as well. So I think if anything, the ground has shifted somewhat, and I think the issue around heat as a service, the use of district heating, in my view, and how that could be through local energy provision, doesn't have to be a big company that's providing that, it could be through a local cooperative type arrangement, has got real potential. And I think that's the model that I'm very open to, and I think could actually be much more productive in creating the change that we're looking for.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Monica. I'm conscious of time, so let me bring in Colette Stevenson for a question or two. Colette, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
I wanted to touch upon the statutory targets that are in place for 2040 and how they apply at our national level, and also at every local authority as well. So there's interim targets as well between 2030 and 2035 as well, but they only appear to apply at national level. Do you expect to see local authorities, you know, facing more difficulties? And if so, you know, what plans are actually in place to see if there's work being done on certain local authorities, particularly in rural areas as well, and how they actually meet those targets as well, and what challenges they're going to face there?
So I think you raise a really important point, because the statutory target for 2040 is a national target, and we've also got the interim targets for 2035 and 2030 at a national level as well. The reason that we have not applied them at a local level in the same way is because of very significant difference you have between different local authorities. So if I take, for example, if you take a local authority like Highland Council, they have the last Scottish Household Condition Survey estimate was, I think it was between 2017 and 2019, estimated they had about 33% of their population experiencing fuel poverty. That's significantly above the 24.6% national figure. So there'll be different approaches will be necessary in different local authorities, and we need to make sure that the way in which we calibrate our programmes and funding support and assistance is that we take recognition that there are local authority areas that have got greater experience of fuel poverty. And the way in which that will be progressed and the planning will be taken forward at a local level. So local authorities just now plan this through their housing stock strategy plans, but we're also working to develop what are local heat and energy efficiency strategies. I'm looking to work with COSLA and local authorities around how they will develop those at a local level and to place them on a statutory footing and to make sure we provide them with the resource support that's necessary to take them forward and implement them. That's a piece of work which we're taking forward at the present moment, and I would expect, I think is it 2023? Or thereabouts, we're expecting local authorities to have these in place, and we're presently looking at how we can put that on a statutory footing to make sure that they've got plans and strategies in place to deliver on the requirements to meet the fuel poverty targets.
Okay, no, thanks for that answer. Just on that, touching upon local authorities as well, and obviously in light of the report that we got as well, which was great, fantastic, comprehensive report as well, thank you. Can I ask where the cold weather payments, how they align themselves, you know, with our fuel poverty strategy? Are they in tandem with that, or is that going to be form part of it? So, and I'm going to be slightly parochial here, because coming from my constituency here in East Kilbride, we tend to have a lot colder weather, given that we're actually higher up. So I'm just wondering whether that cold weather payment, how it applies, and even the weather stations that they use as well, the impact, if that's been considered as part of the fuel poverty strategy.
So, and I acknowledge the fact that the East Kilbride can have its own micro weather system at times.
Yes, it can.
So, different from that of the rest of Lanarkshire and Greater Glasgow. There's a couple of schemes which are in operation just now, which is the Warm Homes Discount Scheme and the Eco Scheme that operates. They are linked into the pension credit scheme for automatic payments, and for those who don't have the right gateway benefits, they require to apply for it at particular points. There is presently engagement with the UK government around potentially changing these schemes. One, to increase the threshold to the £140, potentially increasing that. Two, we would like to merge both the schemes into a single scheme rather than having two separate schemes operating, and we're engaging with the UK government on that. I've taken a matter up with Lord Callaghan, who is the minister at a UK level that's dealing with this, to see if we can try and simplify the scheme and shift the threshold to increase the number of people who would receive it automatically, potentially, which would help to make it a quicker, and it would also make it one where individuals don't have to apply because they aren't aware of it, or that they just simply lose out on it, that there's a greater certainty around them getting it as well. So we are looking, there are areas, this requires agreement from the UK government and the Secretary of State for Business, and we've engaged with them to look at whether we could look at simplifying the system here in Scotland in a way that would help to provide a greater range of automatic payments around the way in which the existing system operates for largely just those that are receiving pension credits.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Colette. Cabinet Secretary, final question, if I may. You've mentioned the heat and building strategy a few times, which is obviously intertwined with the fuel poverty strategy. The Scottish Government has set out an estimated cost of £33 billion, I believe, for the entire retrofitting and ancillary work necessary for the housing and building stock in Scotland. That funding will come from a combination of public sector funding and private sector funding. Mm. When do you think the Scottish Government will have a better idea of how that will that sum is going to be divided between public sector funding and funding from the private sector?
So it'll be public sector, private sector and individual funding that will meet the costs of the heat and building strategy. I can't give you a specific date to say we will have X amount banked from the private sector to deliver it. What I can say is that we are in discussions with private sector organisations around the scope to which they may be able to help to deliver on some of this. I know during the course of COP I met with a number of different companies who were interested in looking at how they could help to support the whole idea of rolling out district heating systems and local energy systems. They've got there's some experience in Scandinavia around these things, which is why we signed the MOU with the Danish government specifically around district heating and heating homes. I think there are, I've had discussions again with the companies in the course of the last week who are interested in looking at how they could support businesses, Scottish-based businesses that have models that they think could actually be scaled up and rolled out. So through the use of, so you may be aware of the Star Energy's facility on the Clyde, which again is a family-owned business that's based in Eastwood in Glasgow, that has the potential to be scaled up and developed. There's a potential for investment in these areas which would be moving much more to a heat as a service type model as well. So I can't give you a date and say that, right, we'll have the £33 billion banked in this date. It's going to be an ongoing piece of work and engaging with the private sector in looking to see areas that they can provide support in meeting the transition as we go forward alongside public sector investment. I think what the public sector investment can do, it can act as a catalyst to generate greater investment in these areas and also help to try and drive down the costs to help to support people who are looking to even invest in it themselves for their own properties. And that's one of the ways in which we're trying to make sure that our investment is focused particularly on social housing to try and help to support the sector to scale up, develop, and also to help to drive down the cost, which can then have a wider economic benefit as more people look to install them in their own properties or as commercial operators start to move into the market as well.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. That brings us to the end of this session. Thank you both for joining us this morning, and I now suspend this meeting for a change of panel members. Thank you. I'll kick off in a second. Welcome back, everyone. Our next item is to take evidence on the Environmental Protection Single-Use Plastic Products Scotland Regulations 2021. These regulations are subject to the negative procedure, but since they raise interesting issues of public interest, we are having a short evidence session with the Scottish Government before we dispose of the regulations formally at a meeting in December. I welcome Lorna Slater, Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity. I also welcome officials who are joining us remotely, Andrew Forsyth, Ailsa Heen and Janet McVeigh. Thank you very much, everyone, for making yourself available to the committee this morning. Minister, I understand that you would like to make a short opening statement. If that's the case, I will hand over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I have got a short statement on this for this item. Every year, hundreds of millions of pieces of single-use plastic are wasted in this country. They litter our coasts, pollute our oceans, and contribute to the climate emergency. That is why the Scottish Government has laid legislation before the Scottish Parliament that bans some of the most problematic single-use plastic products and helps us move to a more circular economy, starting from June 2022. The items included in the single-use plastic regulations are single-use plastic cutlery, such as forks, knives, spoons, and chopsticks, plates, straws, beverage stirrers, and balloon sticks. Food containers made of expanded polystyrene and cups and other beverage containers made of expanded polystyrene. The regulations will be the first in the UK to ban such a wide range of single-use plastic items and go further than the single-use plastic bans currently in force in the rest of the UK. These products cover 86% of all single-use plastic items on European beaches, about half of all plastic marine litter. And I came across this last night when doing some reading, that the most recent data from the Marine Conservation Society's 2020 Great British Beach Clean found plastic and polystyrene pieces are the most common item found littered on beaches by a large margin. I do recognise that the ban is at risk from the UK Internal Market Act, which effectively exempts any items that are produced in or imported via another part of the UK. Officials continue to work with the other administrations across the UK to try and find a way to ensure that the ban is not undermined. Extensive consultations have been undertaken with stakeholders during the development phase of the regulations. This included industry, non-governmental organisations, equalities groups, users of the products, and of course the general public. Findings from these consultations were taken into account in the final drafting of the regulations and will also help inform ongoing work in this policy area. Action has been taken to limit the impact on Scottish businesses. The regulations will come into force in June 2022, giving businesses time to take action to prepare for the new measures. A guidance document has also been published on the Scottish Government's website. Feedback on the impact on the wider public has also been taken into account. Crucially, the legislation includes exemptions for single-use plastic straws to make sure that those who need them for independent living or medical purposes can still get access to them. This means they can be supplied in particular settings and circumstances as before, and can still be sold under certain conditions in a pharmacy. Enforcement work will be undertaken by local authority enforcement officers. Enforcement officers will be authorised by local authorities to exercise powers in the regulations in order to determine whether an offence has been committed. In addition to the incredibly important environmental policy aims of this legislation, the Scottish Government continues to be committed to matching or exceeding the standards of the EU Single-Use Plastics Directive. The products covered by these regulations therefore help align Scottish legislation with Article 5 of the EU Directive. The measures cover all products in Article 5 except for oxo-degradable plastic products. Oxo-degradables is an area of significant complexity and rapid change, and it is important that we make a decision based on the most up-to-date information. The policy intention remains to ban oxo-degradable products via further regulations next year. We are currently collecting this evidence in advance of taking action and will provide an update in due course. Further work is ongoing to match or exceed the standards in the other articles of the EU directive through measures you will already be aware of, such as the deposit return scheme and extended producer responsibility. The single-use plastics regulations, then, are another important step forward in our efforts to tackle Scotland's throwaway culture by reducing our reliance on single-use plastic and encouraging more reusable and sustainable alternatives. They are one part of a wide array of policy measures that will help move Scotland to a more circular economy. And as already noted, further action is to follow through key initiatives such as the deposit return scheme. Thank you. I hope I'll be able to answer any of your questions.
Thank you very much, Minister. That was very helpful. You mentioned that the definitions used in the negative instrument are very technical indeed in terms of the items covered in the ban. Given that, what specific guidance has been given to small business who might be affected by the regulations, particularly given that breach of the regulations can result in a criminal offence?
Extensive consultation with Scottish businesses has been undertaken in the preparation of these regulations, including feedback on the draft regulations that were made public earlier this year. The regulations come into force, as I said, on June 1st, 2022, giving Scottish businesses 6 months to prepare. This followed feedback from consultations that less than 6 months would not be enough time to prepare for significant regulatory changes for businesses already dealing with the twin headache of Brexit and COVID-19. For example, some businesses buy stock 6 months in advance and so would be running the risk of having a lot of stock they would have to dispose of, but businesses did generally support the proposals. The vast majority of these products are imported into the UK and are not produced in Scotland, and the move to the circular economy will create many exciting opportunities for innovative Scottish businesses to take advantage of. The specific question as to what the penalties are, I will have to ask officials to help me out on.
That's fine. We can come back to penalties later. I think some of my colleagues have questions on penalties. Just a follow-up question on the consultation process. Obviously, a number of individuals and organisations fed into the consultation process. In terms of the business organisations that you or officials met with, can you explain or describe what that consultation looked like? How many business organisations did you actually meet with to discuss the impact of the regulations?
Absolutely, I've got some more information on that here. So there were two public consultations conducted as a part of a wide range of stakeholder engagement. The first consultation sought views on the items to be covered by the regulations and how restrictions might be implemented. This consultation received positive feedback from individuals and organisations on the plans. The second public consultation was on the draft regulations themselves. Responses were used to fine-tune the regulations and as indicators for what subjects should be included in the online guidance document. Extensive stakeholder engagement was undertaken throughout, including with industry through in advance the first public consultation and through open dialogue throughout the process. Internal Scottish Government colleagues through discussions with experts in areas such as health, equalities, pharmacy, EU alignment and constitution. Users of single-use plastic products such as through a straws advisory group facilitated by Inclusion Scotland, focusing on equalities issues. Zero Waste Scotland, who have provided policy and analytical support throughout the process. We spoke to the other UK administrations, NGOs through the consultation process and direct engagement, and to the general public.
Thank you very much. Let me bring in Liam Kerr at this stage.
Thank you, Davina. Good morning, Minister. Given the financial assessment says that there will be a minimal impact, can you help the committee understand how many businesses are actually impacted, both by number and value, and what mitigation is being considered for those businesses who are impacted, both as producers but also as users?
I'll need to get my officials to help me with the specific numbers. There are many benefits, obviously, to Scotland from having less litter on our beaches, and the cost involved in picking that up, and that involves our tax money being used to collect the litter on the beaches. So the overall positive effect on the economy is very strong, but I'll turn to my officials for details on the businesses affected. Are we able to bring in one of the officials?
Good morning. In terms of the exact number of businesses, as the Minister has communicated quite clearly, it's a very small percentage of Scottish businesses who manufacture these items. As the Minister has also noted, our ban doesn't just ban the supply of these items, but also the manufacturer, noting our global ambition here. In terms of the directive, has been published since 2019, so businesses have adapted and have moved with the market alongside this. And during the consultation process, there was general support, as well as obviously those UK-wide direction and policy ambition to match Scotland here.
Respectfully, I'm not sure that answers my question in terms of the value and the number, but we move on. I mean, a related question is around what is the impact on the Scottish supply chain, again, both in terms of numbers and value, please, Minister.
I don't have the numbers for the Scottish supply chain in front of me. Again, maybe officials can help with that.
Thank you, Minister. A full business impact assessment was conducted and consulted upon during the process, which outlines all the key figures. It's published alongside our regulations, and we can provide a copy to the committee to answer your question.
I'd be very grateful if you would. Final question from me, Minister, a slightly different angle. If I may, I have the regulations here. Part 3 potentially fixes corporate liability onto directors and managers and even members, and I presume that means members of something like a club. Is this usual? And what representations have you had from legal or business bodies on this particular provision?
Please? That's a very technical question, so I'll need to go to officials for that one as well.
Yes, Minister, I can answer the question. Yeah, it's not an unusual provision in these types of regulations to make provision for corporate bodies in relation to the offences. And these regulations are similar to regulations that have already been made to ban cotton buds, microbead. They also have similar provisions.
Just on that, I'm very grateful to Ailsa for the answer. I wonder if you can provide it. The second part of my question was what representations you might have had, and similar to my previous question, I wonder if those might be provided to the committee afterwards, if that wouldn't be any trouble.
You mean from which kind of organisations? From
I asked about legal or business and or business organisations who might have made representations around this particular part 3.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I think we can check. I don't know off the top of my head which representations we had on that.
Very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Liam. Let me bring in Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and your officials. I was pleased to hear you say, Minister, that you were doing some reading last night about the result of the Great British Beach Clean and Marine Conservation Society's involvement in organising that. You'll know from that reading that the second most common item to be found in terms of, you know, pollution of our beaches and coastline is wet wipes that contain plastics. So I just wondered if you can give us an update in terms of whether that would be the next step. You know, would a ban in wet wipes come next? I know there's a 10-minute rule bill in Westminster, and I think Marine Conservation Society have said that banning single-use plastic wet wipes is such an easy step to take in order to help achieve a circular economy. So really would like your thoughts on that.
The member is absolutely correct, and thank you very much for highlighting this very serious problem of wet wipes that contain plastic that don't biodegrade, that end up on our beaches. And Scottish beaches are more strongly affected than anywhere else in the UK. I've just got the numbers in front of me, something like 5 times more wet wipes on Scottish beaches than anywhere else. So this is absolutely something that we need to take action on. It's the largest single component material found in sewage system blockages as well, obviously, which costs a lot of money, and the vast majority of those currently contain plastic. Wet wipes containing plastics were included in a list of potential additional items to be banned in the future in the public consultation for this single-use plastic regulations, with 94% of the respondents in favour. So when we consulted on this regulation that we're looking at today, we also asked about wet wipes, and 94% of people agreed that they should be banned. So the Scottish Government are encouraging the UK Government and other administrations to work with us to bring forward a ban on wet wipes containing plastic, which we consider unnecessary and environmentally harmful. Some of the other approaches that are considered on wet wipes, such as labelling, a design standard, or an EPR scheme, we do not consider will address the growing problem in a timely manner, hence why we're trying to encourage the other UK administrations to work with us on a ban. We know through experience of banning harmful products such as plastic-stemmed cotton buds in 2019 that this is an effective solution to the problem.
Thank you, Minister. So I just wonder then, is it the case then that the Scottish Government cannot add wet wipes to the list at present? And secondary to that, how often will the list of restricted items be reviewed?
So I think the approach is the EU directive from which this is Article 5 has many other articles in it which cover things such as wet wipes, but also the extended producer responsibility and other items. Article 5 is just the first piece of that to come forward. The other articles will come forward in their own time. Because it is the Scottish Government's intention to align with this directive, even though we are no longer members of the EU, the idea is we would continue to bring those forward on their original timescales. Wet wipes being such an urgent issue, though, it's something we're looking at, seeing what we can do sooner, ideally a ban throughout the UK nations, but it's something we're actively looking at just now.
Thank you.
Very much. Thank you, Monica. Jackie Dunbar, please.
Minister, you touched briefly before about, you know, protecting our environment as a devolved matter, and the regulations that we're considering today would go a long way to achieve that. But and you also said that that could be undermined by the UK government's internal market bill. So with that in mind, can I ask if you can set out how the UK government is engaging with you on the issue and what the implications would be if the exemption is not made?
Thank you very much for the question. In line with the programme for government commitments, the regulations have been laid before the Scottish Parliament earlier this month, and they'll come into force in June, as discussed, banning the manufacture and supply of these very problematic plastic products. Alignment in relation to the policy measures of these regulations with the other UK administration was not possible due to uncertainty around the final content of the UK government and Welsh Government's legislation and the inability for UK Government and Welsh Governments to legislate as soon as the Scottish Government. We basically got ahead of them. So to address the first part of the question, this is precisely the scenario that the Scottish Government and environmental organisations warned would arise with the UK Internal Market Act. You can have democratically accountable Scottish ministers implementing policy and being accountable to the Scottish Parliament, or you can have the UK Internal Market Act, but you can't have both. Whilst we still fundamentally oppose the Act, officials have been engaging on the preferred option of securing an exclusion from the Act in this policy area through a common frameworks process. Agreement has now been reached on the process by which agreements can be reached within the common frameworks areas that can be excluded. UK ministers will shortly make a statement in Parliament to that effect. This is an early test of the UK Minister's commitment to act in a way that respects the framework process. This won't make the Act any more compatible with devolution, but it will allow a degree of protection for policy areas covered by common frameworks. And regarding what the implications would be if an exemption to the impact of the UK Internal Market Act is not made, if an exemption to the impact of the UK Internal Market Act is not made, then this will mean that any products that are produced in or imported by another part of the UK can still be sold in Scotland, which means hundreds of millions of pieces of plastic would still end up on our beaches if an exemption is not allowed. This will mean that without exemption, the Act will undermine our ban on these environmentally damaging plastic products. So we will continue to work with the other administrations across the UK to try and agree an approach to managing the implications of the Act for the ban. I will be attending an interministerial meeting on this topic next week with the intention of explaining the Scottish Government position and seeking answers from my counterparts. We now look to the UK Government to honour their commitments that they made during the passage of the Internal Market Act to protect frameworks and to exclude this policy area from the scope of the Internal Markets Act. I will also be writing to the UK Government to ask them to take the necessary steps to protect the integrity of our ban.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie. Let me bring in Colette Stevenson, please.
Hey, thanks. Good evening. Good morning, Minister. I wanted to really touch upon the public procurement aspect of it and what impact assessment, if any, has been done in terms of if the legislation was to be rolled out. Because obviously there's obviously a variety of different frameworks in place, even from a local authority level. And, you know,
how do you align them? You're talking about a banning within 6 months. I'm just wondering what work has been done on this, could there possibly be a legal challenge there from the companies who currently have those tender frameworks as well?
Thank you very much for the question. So I'll talk to you about the impact assessments that were done, and then I may need to hand to officials for the more detailed legal question. So the following impact assessments were completed with the Business Regulatory Impact Assessment, Strategic Environmental Assessment, Equality Impact Assessment, Fairer Scotland Duty, Island Communities Screening Assessment. Work performed as part of the impact assessment process found that restricting the availability of plastic straws may impact on some people with protected characteristics more than others. This included the loss of independence and loss of functions related to eating and drinking, which other straws don't provide. So targeted exemptions on the ban of single-use plastic straws are included. So that was a key finding of the impact assessments. Significant findings for the business impact assessment, which is related to what you're asking about, is that the vast majority of the products covered are not made in Scotland, so they're not commonly accessible, manufactured here. That alternative materials to these are already readily available. I know my chippy uses cardboard. It's not that alternatives are hard to get or expensive. The economy-wide impact of introducing these restrictions does have a cost compared to business as usual, but the net present value is generally increasing the item costs in particular, meaning because some of the alternative items have higher costs. I'll turn to officials to answer the question about the legal impact and specifically your question around public procurement, because that is not covered here.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. As noted previously, the directive itself has been published since 2019. The Scottish Government have been clear their intention to bring forward these regulations. Ever since that point, the Scottish Government and our partners at Zero Waste Scotland have communicated clearly that we intend to bring the regulations in, supporting those in the public sector in their procurement decisions, encourage them to take early action ahead of the regulations being laid and coming into force next year. We continue to work with Zero Waste Scotland on messaging and supporting businesses on how to transition to new procurement arrangements.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions at this time. Thanks.
Thank you, Colette. Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks, Kavir. I think we've pretty much exhausted all the questions, really, but I suppose I just have just a couple of ones that were still left. I mean, one was around fishing gear, which I think has been identified alongside wet wipes as a particular problem. I'm sure with the MCS survey as well, Minister, you'll see that we often have fishing gear washing up on our beaches, and it's a difficult problem to deal with. And the other question was just around that common framework, that resources and waste common framework. Is it operational? I think you said earlier that you're now entering into meetings with other administrations, and I presume that DRS and alignment on DRS and a lot of other things will be part of that conversation, including extended producer responsibility. But I think do we have a sensible basis on which to move forward on circular economy policy decisions across the UK? Is that framework operational? And what are we doing about the fishing gear?
Thanks very much for the question. I mean, the member is correct that the framework process to allow exemptions to the Internal Markets Act is going to be absolutely critical to us being able to tackle litter and implement the circular economy. That framework is underway. So I can give you an update on how that's doing. There are challenges here, as I'm sure you understand. Protecting the Scottish environment is a matter of devolved competence. The EU directive, which was the basis for these regulations, came into force in 2019, as the official has pointed out, while all the nations of the UK were still in the EU before the Internal Market Act was created. So the Internal Market Act, in potentially undermining Scotland's ability to protect our environment from this damaging pollution, represents an assault on devolution, the like of which we have not experienced since the current Scottish Parliament was established. Scottish ministers remain fundamentally opposed to the imposition of this act. However, we are working on this common framework process. Our government officials have worked closely with officials from the other UK governments to design these frameworks where they are necessary, in line with the principles of common frameworks, which we agreed in October of 2017. Now, these principles include the agreement that as part of the process for establishing any common frameworks, the devolved institution's competence would not normally be adjusted without their consent. So the frameworks are supposed to maintain, as a minimum, equivalent flexibility for tailoring the policies to the specific needs of each territory, as was afforded by the current EU rules. So the answer to your question in the short form is these frameworks are under development but have not yet been committed to. So there's always the worry that the UK government might not maintain, what, like they won't keep their promise to implement these frameworks as we agreed in 2017. And so that's what I'll be asking them next week, is to continue to work on these frameworks and allow these exemptions, which not only apply to these very important areas of single-use plastics, but specifically to the extended producer responsibility scheme, which ourselves and the Welsh government have much stronger ambitions in than the UK government does in terms of timeline and what's involved in that. And I think it's really important that each nation in the UK is able to move on these at the pace that works for them. And I even spoke to Lord Deben of the Climate Change Committee last week, and he supports this approach because he likes the idea that each nation will challenge the other, and that each nation that steps ahead, as Scotland is doing with these, will challenge the other nations to align with them and then pull ahead, so that we have a continually improvement approach where we are reducing waste and preventing litter.
Yeah, I think it was Rodri Morgan who said that devolution was a great laboratory, and it's the opportunity to innovate there is definitely there. But can you if I can just ask you just again then about the fishing gear side of things, is that
is not covered in these regulations that we're talking about today. But as with the wet wipes, I'm aware that it is a very significant marine litter issue, also a safety issue. We see pictures all the time of animals being affected by that. Mm-hmm. So I am not aware of which regulations cover that. I don't know if officials have that information just now, but I'm more than willing to come back and discuss that with you.
Yeah, it's a pressing issue.
I've taken a note of that. I don't know if officials have any specific comment on fishing gear at this time or whether we should come back to the member on that.
Yes, Minister, I would agree that we can come back with further information on that. I was just going to offer two other comments in relation to earlier questions, if the convener is happy with that.
Yes, please.
Briefly, just on provisional frameworks, to confirm that those have been established to ensure that we have had interim arrangements in place following the end of the transition period. And really, those arrangements that have been operationalised at official level have provided us with a very good platform to be engaging with counterparts across the UK to discuss the impacts of the Internal Market Act. And just to pick up the earlier point in terms of impacts across the supply chain, I didn't get a chance to come in there. We'll certainly be very happy to provide some further information on that, as Andrew says, in terms of the full business regulatory impact assessment. To clarify that the impacts across the supply chain in effect could be identified at three potential levels, both at the point of producing plastics, manufacturing items, distributing items and then supplying those items to end users. The full business impact assessment includes a Scottish firm's impact test, and we engaged specifically with a number of organisations to inform that. Full details, as I say, are set out in the BREA. As the Minister noted, businesses generally in our consultations to date have expressed support for the proposals, and in terms of the headlines from the BREA, I think the expectation is that Scottish polymer producers would have likely minimal impact. Manufacturers, if they do manufacture some of the items that are affected, there would be potentially some minimal impact. However, there are also opportunities as well, particularly as some of the manufacturers would develop alternative.
Looks like we've got a slight technical issue with one of our panel members online. Mark, did you have a supplemental or other question? If not, I believe Liam Kerr has a supplemental.
Yes, thank you, Convener. And that was unfortunate. I was very interested in what Janet was saying there. So hopefully we'll get that back shortly. Minister, I understand the intention is to publish guidance to help those affected by the regulations. What is the current status and timing of that guidance, do you know?
My understanding, and officials can correct me, is that that guidance is to be on the website. I understand that that's ready now, but the officials can correct me on the specific date for that.
That's right, Minister. The guidance is published online. It's published in draft form, and we're looking to continue to engage to ensure that guidance is robust. But the final version of that guidance being published on the 1st of June when the regulations come into force.
Thank you.
Thank you, Liam. Minister, you said earlier that these regulations are part of a wider policy approach for a circular economy, and as part of that, the deposit return scheme will supplement these regulations as well. To help the committee with its work planning, when can we expect to see the legislation to introduce the deposit return scheme?
I'm afraid I don't have a timeline for that just now. I'll be making an announcement to Parliament on that imminently, as soon as I possibly can. We are all aware of the urgency of getting that scheme implemented for Scotland, and I am working on it very hard, but I'm afraid I haven't got a timeline today.
I completely understand. No, you don't have a specific timeline, but do you think it will be this side of the summer recess, like June next year, or do you think we're looking at potentially, you know, longer wait for the legislation to be introduced?
I will come and make an announcement to Parliament on that. I intend to do that before the Christmas recess to update Parliament on that. Hopefully that will be possible.
That is great. I believe there are no further questions. That brings us to the end of this session, Minister. Thank you very much for joining us this morning, and also thank you to your colleagues online for joining the committee. I will now suspend the meeting for a changeover of panel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back, everyone. Our next item is the consideration of a statutory instrument on the Land Reform Scotland Act 2016, Register of Persons Holding a Controlled Interest in Land, Amendment Regulations 2021. I welcome Mary McCallan, Minister for Environment and Land Reform. I also welcome officials joining us remotely, Fiona Taylor, Anna Leslie and Kirsty Slee. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us this morning. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I will now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement with regard to the instrument. Minister, over to you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you and good morning to the committee. I am very pleased to be here with you this morning to help bring the new Register of Controlled Interests in Land one step closer to that go-live date, which is, of course, the 1st of April 2022. As members will know, the Register itself presents a huge step forward in delivering transparency by making clear the identity of those who are making decisions about land in Scotland. The Register itself was a commitment from the Land Reform Act 2016, and the principal regulations implementing it were passed unanimously by the Parliament in February of this year. Passed unanimously, no less, after 8 committee sessions, and I should just like to take the opportunity to thank your predecessor committee for the commitment and the scrutiny that they offered to the regulations. Just by a very quick way of reminder of what the Register does, it will complement information which is already available in the Land Register and the Sazines Register about the owner of land, with information about associates, i.e. those who have an influence on the owner and are taking decisions about how the land is used. It will create greater transparency. It will create greater transparency than any other part of the UK and take us to the forefront of Europe in that regard. And as from my days as a commercial property lawyer, I know how useful that will be. So the policy is unanimously agreed, but the SSI before the committee this morning is to address a very technical flaw which has arisen due to the complex interaction between trust law on the one hand and conveyancing law and the Registers of Scotland on the other. And it concerns the situation where trustees resign or die. In as simple terms as it's possible to use, and I hope that this is clear, the flaw means that when a trustee named on the trust documentation and registered in the Land Register or the Sazines Register as the owner either dies or resigns, there will be no registerable recorded person for the purposes of the new register. That's largely because for the purposes of the regulations, the recorded person flows from the Land Register and the responsibility to identify the associates flows from the recorded person. And for those who know trust law, the problem there is that you automatically cease to be owner or a trustee on death or resignation, but that doesn't correlate with the Land Register, which requires a conveyance. So it's very difficult to describe, actually, the complexity of it, but it's necessary to give rise to the original policy intent, because actually tackling the opaqueness of trust law was one of the original intent of the Register itself. So the Register has been subject to significant policy development parliamentary scrutiny, but it was in the workshops run with Registers of Scotland to facilitate the IT build of the Register that this small flaw was identified. We've shared the proposed SSI with a multitude of stakeholders, including the Law Society of Scotland, Scottish Property Federation, the Land Commission, Community Land Scotland, Scottish Land and Estates, none of whom raised any concerns. So it's necessary to, it's a small tweak, it's necessary to give rise to a very ambitious piece of land law, and I should be very grateful if the committee would propose that it's approved. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. We'll now move on to questions from members of the committee in relation to the instrument, and I will pass over to Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, I remember those eight sessions fondly, and I don't remember this issue ever coming up, so it's interesting that it's come up actually through the extensive IT build as an issue with that due diligence. I suppose it seems like a very logical loophole just to close. I suppose my question is, where are we in terms of the timescale now for the rollout of this register and indeed building a seamlessness for the public and users of these multiple registers that they can then come together to a portal and they can find out who owns land and who's influencing the ownership and management of that land in a way that makes sense to ordinary people that don't have the benefit of experience of conveyancing and trust law and everything else?
I'm not sure I would call it benefit. No, you're absolutely right. So part of the reason that we're bringing this now and that we're keen to have this solved now is to allow that seamlessness with the register due to go live from April next year. So if we can overcome this issue that's been identified, we are still on track for the opening of the register in April next year. And, you know, we could have potentially considered sorting a loophole like this after the fact, but it is about that deliberate intent to make this a smooth transition to the creation of the register, which is why we're bringing it now.
Okay, so we're still on track with the original date then?
Yes.
Of April? Okay.
Yes.
All right, that's it for me.
Very good. I believe there are no more questions. Thank you, Mark. That brings us on to agenda item 5, which is formal consideration of motion 2176, calling for the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee to recommend approval of the Draft Land Reform Scotland Act 2016, Register of Persons Holding a Controlled Interest in Land Amendment Regulations 2021. I invite the Minister to move the motion.
Moved, Convener.
I invite contributions from members. I see that members don't have any additional contributions to make. I would invite the Minister to provide additional information if she so wishes. If not, she can finally move the motion.
I'll move the motion, thank you.
Fantastic. The question then is that motion 2176, in the name of the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, be approved. Are we all agreed? Excellent. We are agreed. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I invite members to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. It's so approved. Minister, that brings this session to an end. Thank you very much to yourself and your officials for appearing before the committee this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
I will now suspend this meeting before we have a further changeover of session. Thank you very much. Welcome back, everyone. Our next item is the consideration of two public petitions. The first petition we will consider is petition 1872 to improve the reliability of Island ferry services. This petition was lodged by Liz McNicol in May 2021 and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to urgently ensure that all islanders have access to reliable ferry services. And I thank the petitioner for lodging the petition. I invite members to note paper 6, which provides some background information and reminds us of our options in relation to petitions. One item to note with respect to the challenges experienced in ferry services across Scotland recently is the fact that Audit Scotland is undertaking a substantial inquiry into ferry services in a number of areas. That report is due to be published in March 2022, and the first step the committee can consider in relation to the petition is to write to the Scottish Government asking what steps are being taken to address the challenges being experienced by island communities and others with regard to ferry services. Are members agreed with that approach? And are there particular issues the members would like to be addressed in the letter to the Scottish Government? Colette.
Yeah, notwithstanding obviously the report that's going to come out from Audit Scotland, convener, I think it's incumbent on us, you know, as a committee, to ensure that some of the other challenges are addressed as well, and that may be a case of actually writing to CalMAC himself in terms of how accessible it is for the people, given it's such a lifeline. For the communities within our islands to access the ferry services. In terms of, you know, what we're doing about, you know, camper vans, emergency accessibility to get to hospital on the mainland as well, and also the white vans as well, in terms of accessing it, to ensure that we're underpinning their economies as well.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with that. And Fiona, in terms of other issues, I think we're looking at writing to the Scottish Government, we're looking at writing to CalMAC, and then depending on the response, we can have an evidence session, depending on the response from the Scottish Government and from CalMAC.
Yes, and clearly the petition was from me, but as we know, there are ongoing and serious issues that islanders are experiencing. So obviously we can look at the Audit Scotland report, which will be about the review of the initial arrangements and learnings in terms of procurement and management of projects. In terms of the current ferry services, if the minister, we should ask the minister, is there anything in advance of the Audit Scotland report he could indicate the steps that are being taken to improve the lifeline and current ferry services. And I think particularly looking in advance of the spring and summer season, because clearly the petitioner was writing and with reference to some of the impacts on tourism. But I think we have to look at things and ask them to look at both the lifeline issues addressed by Colette, but the implications going forward, and similar issues, I think, to CalMAC, because it was good to see that I think this week they've got half price costs and tickets for schools, you know, taking part in activities on the mainland. That's a long-standing issue. That's good to see. But there may be other practical steps they've taken, we need to make sure that that's put on the record and really understood, and if we need to come back on that. But the minister obviously may want to come back to us in advance of the Audit Scotland report if there is anything substantial that they can announce to you know, improve the lifeline services, as well as look forward to the tourism season.
Absolutely. No, I completely agree with those points. Monica.
Thank you, convener. I agree with the points that colleagues have made, so I think it would be good to write to both the government and to CalMAC. I agree with the deputy convener that the issues raised by the petitioner, which dates back to May, are fairly urgent, and you know, we can't wait until after the Audit Scotland report, which will look at, you know, perhaps a narrower set of issues. So I think it is right that this committee takes further action. And again, just want to thank the petitioner for bringing this matter to the Parliament's attention.
Thanks very much, Monica. Liam Kerr, please.
I have nothing to add to the very important comments that have already been made, Convener. Okay.
Thank you, Liam. Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, I would agree with all the comments that colleagues have made so far. I mean, I think one important part of access is about the cost, particularly for those who are, you know, vulnerable or can't afford regular travel. And I know that many young people in the islands, you know, use a ferry service in the way that people in the mainland might use a bus service. So it would be useful to know what consideration Scottish Government has given to that. We've got the rollout of concession travel for under 22 starting in January on the buses. But interesting to know if the government's done any analysis of cost of extension of that for ferries. And just within the scope of the Fair Fares review as well, I know the Transport Minister is announced several weeks ago in detail how that will look at the structuring of ferry prices and how that impacts on people who are struggling maybe.
That's a very good point, Mark. Thanks for that. Does any other member have any other thoughts? I think we're agreed in terms of the next approach. To write what will probably be quite a lengthy letter to the Scottish Government setting out a number of these concerns, and also a similar letter to CalMac. And I think in terms of this line of inquiry, I think this will be an ongoing line of inquiry for the committee. We don't want to duplicate some of the work being done by Audit Scotland, but at the same time, as you said, Monica, I think it's important to take up the concerns raised in the petition and to see what the response is from the Scottish Government and CalMac. Thank you. We now turn to petition 1815, translocate protected beavers to reduce licensed killing. This petition was lodged by Steve Micklewright on behalf of Trees for Life in August 2020. It's calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to initiate a programme to translocate protected beavers to suitable habitats to minimise the need to kill animals adversely impacting arable farmland. I again refer members to paper 6. This sets out relevant background information, including a highly relevant court case in which the petitioners were involved, which concluded recently. It also highlights a recently announced new policy on the translocation of beavers. And by way of background, Nature Scott were in touch with the Clarks yesterday afternoon. They comment in relation to paragraph 7 of the Clarks paper that they take a slightly different interpretation of the court judgment in relation to paragraph 7, and they would prefer the first sentence of paragraph 7 to read as follows. The judgment ruled that Nature Scott erred in law by not setting out the reasons why it was issuing the management licences. I provide members with that background to simply put on record Nature Scott's views in relation to that court case. Now, members should note some developments have happened since the petition was lodged. The Scottish Government has recently announced that they will begin to identify new sites for the translocation of beavers, and there will be a consultation with local communities who may be affected to identify and mitigate possible areas of conflict. In addition to this, Nature Scott is currently in the process of drafting guidance which will be used to show future consultees how they will handle conservation translocation applications, how their views can be presented, and what would be expected from a competent and fair consultation exercise. With that background, I invite thoughts from committee members in terms of how we can respond to the petition and what we should be highlighting to, for example, the Scottish Government and Nature Scott. Mark, you would like to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I suppose first thing I should say is congratulations to the petitioners, because you know, they've now got a change in government policy and translocations are now happening. There was one, I think, that happened yesterday in the Stirling area. So, you know, this is now happening, which is great. I suppose, to be fair, though, like there is some follow-up work that's needed on the back of this, I think, Convener. I think probably writing to the Scottish Government would be useful, but I do think that writing to Nature Scott at this point to get more detail about how they see the change in the beaver management framework going forward, I think that would be useful. I think particularly looking at existing licences for lethal control, looking at how translocations can be funded as well, how the process can be streamlined. I know some of that will be coming through forthcoming guidance, but I suppose I'd be reluctant to close this petition quite yet, because you could look at this and say, well, actually, pretty much everything the petitioners have asked for is now happening, but I think there's probably some future issues around guidance and the management framework that need to be followed up on, I think, to ensure that we're actually going to get substantial change here.
I would agree with that. I think your point about the financial implications of translocations is an important one as well. Is there adequate budget in place? Because I would imagine this would impose some additional budgetary requirements in this new policy area. Do other members would like, Monica, you would like to come in?
Yes, thanks, Convener. I'm not sure if Kieran Jenkins from Channel 4 News is aware of our discussion this morning, but members might want to look at a very lovely Twitter thread, including a video of the first family of beavers in Scotland to be moved to their new home. So definitely agree with Mark Ruskell, there's some good news to be seen there. But like Mark, I also have some questions about how this will be operationalised, any sort of resource and funding requirements. Maybe just to ask Nature Scotland and the Scottish Government for their response to the recent court ruling. I think there might be some matters there that could be open to different interpretation. And maybe questions from a landowner perspective as well about any compensation around adaptation measures. I note that 115 beavers were shot and killed in Scotland last year. That's about a tenth of the population. And although there's a change in policy, there is still scope for licensing around sort of lethal measures. So again, just to get a better sense of what that's going to look like going forward.
Yeah, thank you very much, Monica. I agree with that. Do other members have additional contributions? The other action I think we should take also is to write to the RAIN Committee to inform them of what we're doing in this area, and to make sure that we are, given the overlap in the remit between the committees, to make sure that we are coordinated with whatever work the RAIN Committee may be undertaking in this area. Okay, well... Yep, Fiona, do you want to come in?
That's fine, thank you.
Okay, great. Well, I think we're agreed. I think there's a significant course of action we can take to follow up on this petition, and I look forward to working with committee members in that respect. Given that we have now dealt with the two petitions, that ends the public session and the public part of this committee meeting. Thank you very much.